Good morning. Can I welcome everyone to this second meeting of the Europe Committee of the fifth session of the Scottish Parliament? Can I welcome the public and also the Cabinet Secretary for Culture, Tourism and External Affairs? Can I remind everyone, including members, to switch mobile phones to silent, and just mention to the witness that the Parliament is moving to digital working, so if members are consulting their equipment during the evidence sessions, it's not because they're rude, it's because we're moving to digital working. Since the last meeting of the committee, we have expanded. Our role is going to expand as a result of a decision by the Parliament. So we have been sent reinforcements and in the shape of Ash Denham and Tavish Scott. I'd like to welcome both our new members to the committee and invite you to make any declarations of interest.
No relevant interest to declare.
I've never been described as a reinforcement before, but I'll take that as a great courtesy. Thank you, Convener. No relevant declarations either. Yeah.
Thank you very much. The committee is now invited to whether to consider item 4 in private. Agreed. Okay. Our main item of business today is an evidence session on the implications of the EU referendum for Scotland. And we're delighted to have Fiona Hislop here with us, as well as Karen Watt, the Director for Culture, Tourism and External Affairs in the Scottish Government. If I could start, Cabinet Secretary, by inviting you to give an opening statement.
Thank you very much, Convener. This is the first time I've appeared in front of this committee. I look forward to working with all of you across the brief, and I'm delighted that the Parliament has agreed to expand the committee. I think it's really important this time that all parties are represented on this committee, a vital piece of work that will have to be carried out over the future period. Obviously, we're meeting very soon after last week's referendum. I was reflecting that this time last week I hadn't actually cast my vote as yet. So a lot has happened over a period of the last week. The First Minister has also committed to meet with the committee at the earliest opportunity, and obviously having secured the support of the majority of Parliament on Tuesday, the First Minister and the Scottish Government will now begin to take all possible steps to explore all options to protect Scotland's relationship and place within the EU. It was reassuring on Tuesday to see colleagues from across the chamber committing to work together and to deliver on our common values and shared responsibility for the people we serve. To that end, we've been in active contact with the European Member States and the EU institutions. Since the UK voted to leave the EU, I've spoken with the Slovak, French and German ambassadors. Dr. Allen has held a briefing with the Consular Corps in Edinburgh on Monday, the 27th. The First Minister has also set up the Standing Council on Europe, experts with a variety of views on Scotland's constitutional future, to advise us on options open to us to protect Scotland's relationship within the EU. Yesterday, as you may be aware, the First Minister was in Brussels on a successful visit where she met with leading figures from the EU institutions and the European Parliament. She explained Scotland's position to leading figures and was received in her own words, a very sympathetic response from those she met with and the European press. Yesterday, I spoke with the UK government's Minister for Europe, David Lidington, where I reminded him of the Prime Minister's commitment to meaningfully involve Scotland and the other devolved administrations, not just in the negotiation, but in the process leading up to it. I'll also meet David Lidington next week. With a clear democratic mandate from Scottish voters to remain in the EU, the First Minister has outlined three priorities for the government. Firstly, to reassure those from other countries who've chosen to make Scotland their home that they are welcome in Scotland. This is their home and we value their contribution. Secondly, to reassure and engage with businesses, organisations and stakeholders. And thirdly, our determination to protect Scotland's relationship with and place in the European Union. In Tuesday's debate, there was concern about the prospect of a second independence referendum. I want to make it clear here today that all options will be considered to protect Scotland's EU relationship, and we will bring our recommendations to Parliament in due course. Tuesday's motion in Parliament called upon the Government to report back to Parliament and to the committee. This is the first of many conversations I think we'll have. I also think we need to think about the appropriate mechanism, particularly during the recess, of how we make sure that members are kept informed. The First Minister has also made a commitment to Parliament to keep party leaders informed of progress, and I ensure I'll do that with my counterparts and leads in other parties, but we can work out the mechanism by which we do that. More than this, the First Minister, as I said, had made clear her intention for a range of committees to contribute to this process. I think the Parliament's involvement, clearly led by this committee, but also it has an impact on other committees, is important, and that's maybe something that we should explore further as well. But that clearly is a responsibility of the Parliament and not of government. Yesterday, the Irish President convener addressed the Parliament in what was a very eloquent and magnificent speech. He reminded us that we must respond to demagoguery with an informed, open, respectful, tolerant and engaged discourse and with respectful debate. We are challenged to do democracy better rather than revert to old and divisive myths based on exclusion and often to what is thinly veiled hate or racism. I think the sentiment that he expressed in his address to us was very meaningful and of the moment, and I hope will inform the spirit and the content of how we take forward our discussions here in Scotland. So I'm very keen to explore with you how we, at this even very early stage, find a mechanism by which we, together, the government and the Parliament, can take forward Scotland's interests.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. If I could start, yesterday's spokesman for the EU Commission President, Jean-Claude Juncker, said that Scotland had won the right to be heard in Brussels. In your view, what's the significance of that statement? Does it represent a sea change in Scotland's relationship with Europe?
Well, the purpose of the First Minister's visit was to make sure that the position of Scotland and our experience in the referendum and the results of the referendum was heard and understood in Europe, and that was certainly achieved. And certainly the feedback that we've had is that people recognise that Scotland voted differently than some parts of the rest of the UK, and it was important that that was understood. So in terms of our relations with Europe, remember in the longer term, and not just from this government, but from previous governments here in Scotland, we've had a very active role in Europe in many fields. Not least in representations from ministers and our position within Europe. Fergus Ewing, as we know, was at the Agriculture Committee on Monday. I've regularly attended council meetings. So Scotland has been an active player and led on many issues like climate change, for example. So, you know, people recognise that we have a position and role, but we are a legal entity as a country. We do have an opportunity to put forward our case. Part of it is making sure that we are listened to, and that's certainly what happened yesterday. And I think the fact that the President of the Commission has said that Scotland has won the right to be heard, it is because, you know, 62% of our country decided that they wanted to remain.
And in terms of all this engagement with European leaders and institutions, what impression have you got from them as to their view of the result of the UK referendum?
Well, again, I mean, I suppose when we're discussing how we really, I don't want to be in a position that obviously confidential discussions that other countries have with us, I can't give you a blow-by-blow report, and they wouldn't expect me to. But I think in terms of, if I can give you a sort of general response, is everybody is in shock. You know, I think I don't think people actually expected this to happen. I think we've seen that within the United Kingdom. But, you know, clearly there's a view across Europe that they wanted the UK to stay and remain. And so, therefore, they themselves are coming to terms with what they see as a result they didn't want. So I think, as I said, it is early days in this. We need to have a plan of what we want to try and achieve. How we do it, in effect, will take some time, but actually we've got to engage early, because if Scotland doesn't engage early, we won't be heard and we won't be expected necessarily to be part of the negotiations. And that's why the twin-track approach with working with the United Kingdom, making sure that we're part of their thinking, their deliberations, is very important, but also recognising that we have to make sure that the different perspectives of Scotland are heard. And I think it's quite interesting that the Prime Minister, David Cameron, recognises also that Scotland should have the opportunity to engage directly.
And have you been able to form any kind of impression as to how other member states will approach the negotiations with the UK? For example, there's been a lot of talk about other member states anxious to speed up the process, if you like, rather than delay matters. But have you formed any impression in your discussions?
Well, I think it's fair to say there probably isn't one view. There'll be different views in different countries for different reasons. Clearly, the Council itself will speak on behalf of all the member states in terms of their position. They're clearly from an immediate call that, you know, the Article 50 should have been lodged yesterday. Remember, that was at one point in the last few days. That was seemed to be the perceived wisdom, or perceived position. There's obviously been a bit of movement recognising there needs to be a bit of space in preparation for an Article 50 lodging. But of course, in some parts, remember, you've got 28 members. We'll need to decide which number we operate with going forward. But in terms of the perceptions, some people will want to move very quickly to change how Europe itself works. Some people want to have Europe come closer together and move more quickly themselves. And some will just look at self-interest. And you remember politics. We are politicians. 6 weeks ago, we were facing an election. And, many other countries will be facing in, the coming year, 18 months elections themselves, and they will want to reflect their own interests in that. So I think it might be wrong to say there is one view. There'll be different views for different reasons, and the whole point of the European Council of Ministers is to bring that collection together to identify what the common interest is for all the member states, but also for the institution itself. The one thing I think we need to be very careful of and be mindful of is that there's a desire to protect the institution itself, and the idea that somehow, and I think the one thing that I think is very strong, this idea that somehow the United Kingdom in its own negotiations can cherry pick or renegotiate what a process. Remember, David Cameron spent the best part of the last 18 months or so trying to get a negotiation package. That has been the process up into the referendum. That the idea that somehow you can revisit that. Now that's now in speculation, etc. But I think there's a quite hard view that they might not be open to that cherry picking. But politics is politics, self-interest is interest, both for the institution and the member states. And if anything, we know from the European institutions is they are pragmatic, but they face a lot of pressures. And I think when we look at this, it's not just from the perspective of the United Kingdom and as a kind of one-way street in terms of the relationship of the UK with institutions. They themselves have their own priorities, and I think we should be mindful of that, not just in Scotland, but also in the UK as well.
Thank you very much. In terms of your discussions with the UK government, the predecessor committee to this committee conducted a piece of work on the implications of Brexit for Scotland, and they brought forward evidence from witnesses about the amount of money that comes direct to Scotland from Europe, the farm payments of, I think, over 800 million, over 900 million euros of structural funds and university research funds, which I believe are around 88 million. Now, that committee, in its report, repeatedly said that the UK government had failed to give clarity as to whether the Scottish Bloc grant, for example, would be adjusted after Brexit to make up for the loss of these European funding. Have you any additional information that you have managed to glean from the UK government as to whether we would be out of pocket or whether they are making plans to readjust the Bloc grant?
Right, in the spirit of consensus, I'm going to try and refrain from necessarily making kind of hard political points, but I think there's a general understanding that there is no plan for immediate Brexit, let alone necessarily what might happen further down the line. So these are all issues that I'm sure will have to be considered as part of the United Kingdom's deliberations. What's important for us, and this is why this Parliament has to think about, okay, how do we make sure that Scotland's interest is protected? The previous system had the committee, this committee working with rapporteurs or lead people in each of our other committees in terms of European interests. And so for an example you used on cap payments, I would fully expect the Rural Affairs Committee to think about that dimension and to think about the positioning of Scotland and how that would be best delivered. And certainly that has to be a part and parcel of our discussions, yes, with the United Kingdom government, but also in recognising what the options might be, working with the Standing Council of Experts to identify what the interests might be for Scotland in our direct discussions and understanding. So I'm trying to be fairly circumspect. I think, yes, I would like to say, yes, there was a blueprint of 650 pages that told us what would happen should there be a Brexit vote. Unfortunately, there isn't. So therefore, we've got to deal with what we've got and try and make sure that Scotland's interest is represented in these parallel discussions.
Thank you very much. I'll just hand over to Lewis MacDonald now, Lewis.
Thank you very much, and it's been helpful to have your appearance so promptly under these very difficult circumstances, as we all recognise. Can I go back to the question of the twin track and ask you a couple of things about that? Because one of the issues that appears to be right at the top of the agenda at the moment is whether when not only when Article 50 would be triggered, but how Article 50 would be triggered. So, for example, Professor Mark Elliott has expressed the view that because the referendum was purely an advisory exercise in law, it has no legal force, and therefore a decision has yet to be made by the United Kingdom to seek to go forward under Article 50. Has the United Kingdom government consulted you on the timing or on the legal and technical requirements that it faces in terms of deciding when to trigger Article 50?
Well, I notice in your witnesses today, you've got a number of people who might be placed to give you the background of the constitutional aspects of Article 50. But in terms of, I've had two discussions with UK ministers. I think what I would reflect is I think we've got an opportunity to recalibrate how the UK government works with the Scottish government in relation to negotiations on this issue. So since the referendum itself, I've now spoken to the Secretary of State for Scotland and David Lidington. And David Lidington, as I said, is due up to meet me next week. And so I think there's a better appetite for engagement than perhaps has been in the last 2 years on these issues. So in terms of, they haven't told me what their plans are because I don't think they have their plans yet. And I think that's to be resolved. And the issue then might be, you know, some of this goes into party politics as to, you know, what can or should be done before a new prime minister is put in place. But I've made it clear that I think they should think carefully about when and how they lodge Article 50, that also for our interests, that it's very important that we're involved in the negotiations or the discussions and the process prior to Article 50 being lodged. I think that's in our interests as well. So I've given quite clear direction as to what I think is in the interests of Scotland. I've yet to have an affirmative response on that. They clearly know our views, and I expect to continue those discussions with David Lidington next week.
And when you describe to David Lidington what Scotland's interest is and what Scotland is looking for in that very early process prior to the triggering of Article 50, what are the fundamental points that you intend to make to him? Is it in Scotland's interest, for example, that is as late as possible? Or is there a view about how it should be done that is specific to what the Scottish Government believes to be an urgent?
Well, there's different pressures. Clearly, you know, some of you, the legal competence for negotiation is with the UK government, so therefore we need to be part of the UK government's negotiations and at the table in those discussions. So that's why the process of this is important. And I think, actually, there's an understanding from the UK government that that's going to be important. But I've yet to have the kind of yes, this will happen aspect. And to be fair, it's a week after the turmoil. You know, as much as, you know, we're frustrated, I think we've got to recognise that that will happen, and we need to keep our pressure up. But in terms of the content and detail of that, that's where, you know, certainly in terms of looking at our priorities, making sure that we keep as many options open is very important for us. There are different, you'll hear, no doubt, in terms of, you know, if you pursue questions in that direction, you know, you can have just a straight Article 50, or you can have, depending on different aspects, whether they don't need to put justifications, rationale, etc. So those options, there are kind of, I think the most important at this stage is trying to keep our options open, both in the process, but also in what the result might be, and what the options, and that's why looking at all the options is very important. We'll need to move fairly rapidly, and there's a lot of thinking going on in that, and that's why I think in terms of the membership of the Standing Council on Europe, the experts in there will give us a range, both on the content detail. So, for example, with Damian Glover in science, and she was previously scientific advisor to President Barroso, an understanding of what the priorities in that aspect might be. But so it's as much about content. We need to think about content as well as process. The content discussions won't necessarily form the content of Article 50 because that's a legal that's a mechanism. But that's why the talks around it are very important, and an understanding of what Scotland's position is. And therefore the dialogue that we can have with other members is very important. The discussions, obviously, which I haven't elaborated on, but very quickly and early, our First Minister spoke to the First Ministers of Wales and Deputy First Minister of Northern Ireland, and I think it's now two conversations with the Taoiseach she's had.
And while recognising it's early, when you meet Mr. Lidington next week, will you be talking to him then about the kind of issues that Scotland will want to address during the negotiations after the triggering of Article 50?
We were looking at the scope. I mean, clearly scoping of those, you know, part of this is process and scope, and that's what you always do in initial initial areas, and that's what we're looking at.
Thank you very much.
Okay. Thanks. I'd like to invite Bruce Crawford.
Thank you, and thank you, Cabinet Secretary, for coming before us so early. It's useful to hear some of the background you've outlined earlier, trying to create new relationships, building on existing relationships with the European Union, how best to prosecute the Scottish position. And that twin-track approach is quite obviously important as far as Scotland is concerned. Interesting words you used about the league calibration with the arrangement with the UK, and as part of that scoping exercise, one of the things that's certainly been exercised in my mind was how flexible the UK might be prepared to be in that scoping exercise in terms of Scotland's position. I wondered whether or not you've yet had the opportunity or will take that opportunity with David Lidington next week or sometime in the near future to discuss with the UK government whether they are prepared in these negotiations post the triggering of Article 50 to argue that Scotland to find an argument in their position and in their negotiating position that Scotland can remain.
I think there's certainly a goodwill now. I think what you're asking is speculation, and I think one of the challenges is that we know that there will be a change of personnel within the UK government, and that makes it very difficult to anticipate what the commitments might be thereafter. And the challenge of a challenge to current ministers to say anything that would tie the hands of people who come after them as early as, you know, beginning of September. That's why keeping our options open is important. So therefore, what's essential just now is that we lock in Scotland's interests and role in the process, so that it's very difficult for somebody, or unreasonable for somebody coming in if they were so willing to change that. Now, I hope that wouldn't happen. It's also why the voice of Scotland, not just at minister to minister and first minister to prime minister, but also at senior civil service level, is very important, because you know, as we know, ministerial positions may change, but the civil service remain. And I think actually having the continuity and at a high level, so therefore within the Cabinet Office, I think it's been called as the, I don't know if it's the Brexit unit, or, you know, I think Oliver Letwin is the minister currently is in charge of that. But that's very important as well, to make sure that we can have a fairly seamless transition from whatever the ministerial team is in the UK government after the recalibration of their internal elections. And that's again why the process of this is very important, so we can try and hit the ground running fairly quickly with whoever comes in as well, and establish some principles up front, which I think if we can again get consensus. And that's why in the, you know, not, there's a bit, obviously, an understatement of a bit of a vacuum across Westminster, actually, in opposition as well as government, that actually a position from Scotland that is reasonable, and also has consensus, will make that transition from one set of ministers at UK government to another a bit easier for us. So that's why I think there's a big responsibility in us collectively to make sure we can achieve that.
Okay, just one tiny supplementary to that, Kinnear. Now, other than political impediments to the UK being prepared to negotiate for Scotland to remain, as well as them Brexiting at the same time, is there any reason to stop that happening?
No, because at the end of the day, if you want to involve people, you can involve people, and that's I think so. The political will is the most important to achieve that. In terms of our discussions that we have with Europe, we can discuss things, we can understand, and I think it's very important for us to understand the different pressures and interests from other member states in working out what our position is, so we can maximise our position within the UK discussions as well. So that's exactly why we have to be able to have a range of discussions, both, yes, within the United Kingdom position, but also internationally, because the pressures that we may have on some issues maybe more of a, more important to us than for the rest of the UK. And if the essential is, you know, is about how do you retain a membership of a single market? You know, what does freedom of movement look like? And particularly on an island which has a common travel area with another island, and that's let alone the dimensions, you know, with the Republic of Ireland as well. So therefore, I think it's absolutely essential that we're very respectful, not just of our own, you know, self-interests and needs, but also of everybody else.
Thank you very much. Jackson, Carla?
Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. You used the word spirit of consensus at some point earlier on. And so can I at face value take both your words and those of the First Minister that she wasn't seeking to negotiate or position, but simply to bring to the attention of as many people across Europe the outcome of the result here in Scotland, and to thank you for doing that, because I think it's important it is understood. We are at this stage not really at the stage of probabilities, not even possibly at desirabilities. We are at possibilities. And one thing that slightly struck me in watching an interview the First Minister gave yesterday with Bernard Ponsonby in Europe was that one of those possibilities seems to me to be that Scotland would remain in the United Kingdom outside of the European Union on the basis of the agreement the United Kingdom finally strikes. Do you accept that that is one of the possibilities, if not one of the desirabilities from your perspective, or even necessarily a probability, but it is a possibility?
I think it's fair to say that the worst case scenario is that Scotland is outside the EU with no improvement and no options and any options closed down. I think that would be a very difficult situation for Scotland to be in, because our interests in Europe are long and extensive. I think that's why I think there's a general consensus saying, look, we need to try and get movement on this. The degree of movement, we don't know yet. It is uncharted, and no. We don't know the results. But that, to me, would be a worst-case scenario. I think generally across Scotland, that would not be ideal. We need to maximise our position.
But if it's accepted, at least as a possibility, that Scotland could be in the United Kingdom outside of Europe and on the basis of the agreement which is finally struck, will a parallel effort be given in the arrangements that you strike with the Secretary of State for Scotland and David Lidington or whoever from the Foreign Office in terms of Scotland's engagement in the discussions that take place which might lead to that outcome, as well as the effort that you put into as a government the substantiation of the other options that you have before you?
Well, I think it's always helpful going into discussions that you prepare for success rather than failure, and I think we want movement. But, you know, if there may be a scenario which we, you know, it's probably had more airtime, and understandably, because people's interest, saying that actually we may get to a position, and acknowledged by David Martin, MEP, I think in similar pieces last night, we may get in a position that the only way that we can ensure our membership and our relations and our status and our interests in Europe is as an independent country, and that may need to happen, you know, as a result of these, as the examination of options. Similarly, if you look at the UK's point of view, there may be a situation where they take an extreme position that is so isolationist it's not even anywhere near the Norwegian model. You've heard Jeremy Hunt talking, saying what they should be aiming for is a Norwegian. That's out of Europe, but with a different negotiation. That still has a negotiation with Europe that tries to get something wrong from Europe in terms of a single market access, freedom of movement, etc. Now, that's on that end of the spectrum of where we might end up. I don't know where on that spectrum we are. I don't even know where the UK wants to get on that area. So for me to try and predict, you said it's never possibilities, but I can understand. So part of our discussions internally with the UK is to try and ensure that they're maximising the position that they have in relation to Europe. I think that will be in our interest. But clearly we have to identify where on this spectrum we can get to it, with all the options. Some of them will have constitutional requirements. But actually, if we focus on the issues of, you know, interests of environment, regulations in relation to our products for export, single market, all these areas which I think you can helpfully scope us out, what are the main interests for Scotland? If we identify those issues, thereafter you can identify which is the best constitutional arrangement that would allow us to do that, or what other types of negotiations you can get from that. Now, that's kind of preempting a lot of where we might end up. But, you know, think about it in those terms. So therefore, we're not even, you can only start to have a discussion and negotiation with people when you know where they might be coming from. I have absolutely hand on heart, no idea where the UK is coming from and what they're trying to achieve. And frankly, we won't, and we might not even know that till September. And my worry is if they move quickly for an Article 50 lodging, either now or indeed at the point of a new leader coming in, if we're not in before that, making sure that our voice is heard and that we get a chance to express our views, it will be very difficult afterwards. So that's my positioning. Things may change. We may have to, we'll have to consider, we've got to be nimble and act and be responsive, but we've got to think about all those considerations.
I mean, I realise time's short, so I won't seek to drill down in any of that today at all, but can I just finally ask, you said that in due course would come back to Parliament with your conclusion. I mean, have you defined in due course in any sense at this stage? Is it at the moment as wide as at any point in the next 2 years during the negotiations that are taking place?
I think in terms of making a judgment on options, and particularly if the requirement would be for an independence referendum, that's the First Minister's made clear that, that most certainly that would be a requirement to come back to Parliament. But I think what we have to do is look at the staging posts of how the options are being assessed, how what possibilities there are. And I'll give you, maybe I'll give you an example of how I personally, as Cabinet Secretary, have approached a similar issue, which obviously this committee will be interested in the BBC Charter. I had worked very closely with the committee. I made sure that there were debates at appropriate times to have a kind of understanding of where we'd got to at that stage, to allow an expression, not just with the individual committee, but the wider, wider Parliament. So my commitment certainly is to make sure that at the appropriate points, and that's where your advice will be important, that we say, okay, where have we got to at this stage? I think certainly coming back into into session, we may want to, by that time, you know, it will be in the same week or just shortly before or shortly after a new Prime Minister is put in place. Expressing the views of Scotland at that point, again, might be helpful depending on where we are. But I also think we should use the committees of this Parliament. One of the strengths of this Parliament has always been the thinking and the cooperation and the drilling down of issues that collectively we can do cross committee. So I know we're going into recess, but I am absolutely convinced that yourselves and others, as well as the government, will be working very hard during that period to make sure that we're maximising our position. So we just have to work out the process, and I'm sure we can work with your clerks to look at agendas and timetables and processes.
Thank you. Can I apologise for the strange noises, Cabinet Secretary? It's something to do with windows and hydraulics, and we are trying to have it fixed. So apologies for that.
My understanding is they're centrally operated, but I've had advice as to how that might be done better. But I will, security staff have given me some advice on that. I will share with that later.
Before I move on to Richard Lockhead, I just wanted to ask a quick supplementary to Jackson Carlow's question. And in terms of the relationship with the UK government, one of the Conservative Party leadership candidates, Theresa May, today said that she intended, if she was successful, to set up a government department that was in charge of Brexit. What are the implications of that for the Scottish government's involvement and influence in the whole process?
I might ask Karen what to come in, because obviously that's an operation of Whitehall as well. But I did say in my remarks that particularly at a time of change of personnel in government, making sure that Scotland is not just operating a minister to minister, prime minister to first minister, but also a senior level, and Scotland's has an opportunity within the UK civil service set up. In this process, to make sure we've got a key position and key voice to be heard, I think is very important. But Karen, do you want to?
Convener, I think that in essence, if there is a new department with a new grouping of civil servants, we will engage in the way that we normally do. So already we have had some very initial high-level contact with the UK government about arrangements, but it is too early to say how that will play out or what role we will play longer term. But we do engage on a regular basis, so how they organise themselves in that regard will be it will be one of the things that we consider, but it will be it won't affect the ongoing relationships that we have.
Okay. Richard Lockhead?
Thank you, Convener, and welcome, Cabinet Secretary. And firstly, I commend the leadership being shown by the Scottish Government and yourself in terms of making sure Scotland's voice is heard. Clearly, given the enormity of what we face, there's a monumental amount of work ahead for Parliament and for the Government to make sure that our voice is heard and Scottish interests are taken forward. There's firstly all the work in exploring the options for Scotland to stay in Europe. Secondly, there's the fact the UK are going to have to negotiate a treaty outlining the terms of withdrawal. And then thirdly, there's going to be the agreement and treaty with the EU about a future relationship. And that's a lot of work and for a lot of effort required for Scotland's voice to make sure we're part of all of these levels of negotiations that are going to be taking place. Presumably, at some course very shortly, the UK civil service are going to be beavering away, preparing to give advice to their ministers. And it's absolutely imperative, I would think, that Scotland is part of that, and there are no working groups set up within Whitehall that Scotland doesn't know about or not, they're not part of. And I just wondered if that was something you give some thought to, and if you're seeking commitments from the UK government that Scotland will be part of all those work streams that behind the scenes will be beginning in the next few weeks or months. I think that's quite an important point.
Yeah. I think that's important advice, probably from the wisdom experience of Richard Lockhead's understanding of how things work, and that's why I know it's frustrating. People want to leap immediately to say, what does a deal look like? What does a negotiation look like in content? But actually, trying to get and nail down the processes, both at ministerial level and within the civil service, is really important. And you're right that we have to make sure that our voice is heard. Yes, EU institutions, and yes, with member states, but also that somehow we're not considered in any shape or form an afterthought, or actually, presented with fait accompli positions on content issues of policies, as to issues around withdrawal that don't necessarily meet Scotland's interests. So I think they're very wise words, and thank you for that contribution.
And my second area of question is that the day-to-day business continues until Scotland exits the EU. Decisions will continue to be taken in Brussels and Luxembourg at the various councils and all the working groups that take place across Europe. And this Parliament will be asked to implement those decisions, and that day-to-day business will just continue. Therefore, we have the issue of how Scotland's voice has been represented in those negotiations, because given the way negotiations work in Brussels, if there's no goodwill on both sides of the negotiating table, if you're not seen as very committed to the future of the agreements that have been put in place, then your voice does not count as much as otherwise would do, and that leaves Scotland with an issue, given the UK's position is to leave Europe. Therefore, I'm very, very worried about what will happen in terms of our influence over decisions that will be taken that affect many of our communities and our economic sectors in this country over the next 2 years, or however long it takes until Brexit. Therefore, is there a case for Scotland to ask for a bigger voice in those negotiations? It's much better to have a pro-European minister leading for the UK delegations in these councils than a minister who wants to leave Europe. That would secure a much better outcome, not just for Scotland, but for the whole of the UK. And also, there's other issues like the vacancy for the EU commissioner, who's resigned. Why are we not asking for that position to come to Scotland and Northern Ireland?
Well, certainly I know for that latter point that the President has appointed somebody else to take on the responsibilities, but in terms of country position, I think that's still open, and I hear what you're saying in regards to that. You're absolutely right. I mean, one of the key things we did day to day, we were Europeans last week, we're Europeans today, and we're Europeans tomorrow, and we're actually members of the European Union until such times as we're not. And our intention is to make sure that Scotland remains. That's our clear position. In terms of, therefore, a lot of our early action was about reassurance and connections with particular sectors, and that happened as of Friday, to make sure that our ministers across different portfolios were engaging actively in different sectors about what their immediate reaction is, any concerns, and how we might address them and help them. And that work continues and goes on. But you're right in terms of how we can maximise our position. There have been instances which maybe you will certainly be aware of, where the UK has known that actually having a UK minister operate in a certain area would be of benefit to the UK's position, because the Scottish minister would get a better hearing necessarily than the UK for particular areas. And you know, I know that, you know, frequently a lot of areas you hear of the conflict that goes on between our position on Europe and the UK's position in different areas, but in a lot of other areas actually we can work in parallel and consensus. And I think a very good example is in relation to some of the climate change negotiations that going on. So therefore, you know, I agree with you that we can certainly be arguing and making sure that Scotland can be up front and centre in a lot of the ongoing, because this is, you know, 2 years still of European councils where decisions are taken. Our chance of influencing, you're absolutely right, realistically, who's going to want to listen to people who want to leave, but actually therefore you know, hearing from people who want to remain to make sure we can maximise our position even within that, how much, you know, we don't want to lose ground in that 2 years. There's a, you know, real risk of that. So therefore, in terms of our interests, we need to make sure that we can be there. And that's why, as part of our planning, because we did have a plan, was to make sure that Fergus Ewing did make sure he was there at the council, represent our interests on Monday. And we're making sure that our representation, as we always had, we always try and attend councils where we can, and to lead for the UK when we can. We don't nearly have the opportunity I would want us to have to lead UK positions, but I have done so on like two or three times. I've led for the UK on the digital discussions on the Audiovisual Council. So it's possible and practical and very pragmatic. And if you have a hold of ministers who might not even want to be in Brussels, at all. And I think if it's a choice between having, you know, somebody who doesn't want to be there, a UK minister who doesn't want to be there, or a permanent representative from the UK as a civil servant, or a Scottish minister, I think it's far better with an understanding the agreed lines and agreed positions that we always go through in these processes, that a Scottish minister should be well placed to lead our position. And I think that's it's just extending what we try and do anyway. But as you said, it's probably more important in the next 2 years than perhaps it's been even in the past 2 years.
Thank you very much. Tavish Scott.
I wonder if I could ask Cabinet Secretary for you to just set out what the options are, because you rightly described earlier on those, and you also said the First Minister has stated that all options are on the table. Could you just say for the committee what those are?
Well, Tavish, I would love to be able to tell you that I know, as of here and now, what all the options are. And I think that's why we've set up the Standing Council on Europe, is to make sure that we can have advice as to what those options are. We know that one of those options may be, if the only way we can, you know, retain and remain as part of the European Union is independence, that is on the table. But there may be other options. We've looked at, you know, people, the speculation of, you know, the Greenland situation, the Greenland-Denmark situation. You know, I know certainly from, I think it was the Liberals, Liberal Democrats' position on federalism in terms of looking at that kind of option. I know that's been floated by different people. Whether that could deliver what we know, I don't know. There's also the far extreme, which is, I think, where Jackson Carr was alluding to, a position when you're out of Europe, you're in the United Kingdom, but they're taking a very extreme position of being out. They may not end up there. I think many people don't. I'm not trying to misrepresent that's what your view is, but you've got a spectrum over here which could actually, you know, say that there's, you're out of the single market, you're out, you know, and because they might not have that negotiation. We don't know. So just as much as I can't speculate at the options at this end of the spectrum of where we went out, I can't speculate on the other end, because we don't know what the position of the UK government is. All I'm saying is that we think there may be options. I can't give you definitively. That's what the First Minister wants to come back to Parliament with, is to let you know what the options may be. But that has to be after the thinking time, and barely a week after the referendum, and you know, only a few days after we've appointed the Standing Council on Europe to give us choice and range and options. I'm not going to sit here and tell you what the solution is. I think we've all got to work to the solution. But all I'm saying is I think we should be exploring every option we can. I don't know what those options are just now. But, you know, I want to make sure we maximise our position, whether it's an influence in the UK and where they're going to be, or whether it's identifying what the track might be for Scotland, you know, separately from that or differently from that. what I don't know is what the difference might be, and that's what the options will be presented in terms of what we're expecting from the advice we'll get. But let's use all the talents, the experience, the brains, the wisdom, and the knowledge in Scotland to get to a solution that you know takes forward and protects Scotland's interests. But I can't here and now, and I don't think it's reasonable to expect me to be able to give you what those options are.
Do you think that by the end of August it'll be clear what those options are?
I think it will be clearer, but I don't know, and I can't give you a definitive, because you know, we've not got an end game in terms of what solution we might end up with. We know that independence may be the only way we can retain and protect those interests, but we are absolutely going into this with an open mind to look at what other options there might be. There might be other, and that's genuinely where the heavy lifting and shifting over the next few weeks. And I think the earlier we can do that, the better, because as much as we want to close our options, we want to make sure our options are open. My worry is once you get into an Article 50 process, they may close very quickly. And that's why, you know, during the recess period, I know there's a lot of work could be carried out by committees, as well as the thinking that we've done in the Standing Council. But, you know, I know people want instant solutions, and people are a lot of people are very saddened and angered by what's happened, and they want to have an immediate, there's a way forward. I think what's important from this place, committee, parliament and government, is that we're determined to find an option, or find a route, or find options that we can look at, and that's where I think we've managed to make even in what is barely a week extensive process and progress in making that happen.
Can I just ask? I think I gathered last night that the First Minister has indicated that the government plan to seek external legal advice on the options. I absolutely take your point that you can't have them today, but self-evidently it's difficult to know what we're talking about until those options are clear to Parliament. Did I get it right that external legal advice was being sought on that?
Well, once we have the advice on the options, it would be appropriate to make sure that has legal advice.
And you probably gathered, because you probably watched the same television programmes I did last night, there's a little interest in having that advice shared with Parliament. Do you agree with that point of view?
Well, I mean, in terms of as much as we can do, we want to be open and transparent, and clearly we can advise Parliament of the existence of legal advice, but we're not there yet. We haven't got the advice.
No, and, I understand
that. I understand why people want to make sure that we can be as open and transparent as possible, but there are, I think that's a matter for the First Minister.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much. Just as a supplementary to some of the comments that you've made, my understanding is that this the Section 50 process, once Section 50 is enacted, you have 2 years and then a guillotine falls. What are the implications of that for Scotland and Scotland's options?
Well, there are lots of... that's why we need to make sure that we maximise the options. They might not lodge the Article 50. I think the intention is they will lodge the Article 50, but that's also a possibility. In terms of the different options, if the guillotine falls and we're out and we've not maximised our position, by the end of the 2 years, then we could be in the extreme position that I was talking about, and that's why the one thing we can't allow us to be in is in that extreme position. People will make a judgment as to if we haven't managed to get a position that maintains Scotland's membership by the end of that 2 years, Scotland will be, as part of the United Kingdom, out of the European Union.
And in that case, we would have to potentially ask this Parliament to give legislative consent to either the repeal of the 1972 Act or indeed open up the 1998 Scotland Act. Can you see any circumstances in which this Parliament would give legislative consent to being pulled out of the European Union against our will?
I think politically the Parliament, if it's expressed its view that it wants to remain, would find that very difficult indeed. But we're not in that scenario or situation as yet. And as I've said, I think that we should approach this with a view that we can be successful in what we're to do. If we just plan for failure, failure is what we'll get. And I don't want to be put into that position. And I don't think we as a Parliament and as a government should be putting the Scottish people into that position by that time.
Thank you very much. Rachel has indicated she wishes to ask a question. Rachel.
Welcome, Cabinet Secretary. I just wanted to ask you, you used the word failure there. Do you think that we should be preparing ourselves for departure from the EU, as well as all the negotiations that you have been making to for Scotland to remain?
Well, we've just gone through a referendum that we didn't want, with a result that we didn't want, and unfortunately, the people who took us there didn't prepare a plan themselves for what would be happening in terms of exit. Our job is to protect the interests of Scotland. That's what we're trying to do, and we're trying to maximise our position within that. But obviously, we've got to be very conscious, as Richard Lockhead's question was, that there's a two-year period. The position we get to in 2 years, we need to make sure we're in the best position possible in whatever scenario. I absolutely understand that, but I do want to make sure we try and make sure that we can get as much for Scotland as we can in that period. That's what people would expect for us. But I just find it very disconcerting as a government minister, having gone through our referendum with, may or may not like our white paper and Scotland's future, but we at least had a kind of blueprint of what could happen and should happen, and a lot of thought and detail in it. I just find it absolutely staggering that we're in this position where things are having to be established now, even basic stuff in early days. I just find it quite unbelievable. But that's what we're having to cope with, and that's what we're having to deal with, and we will try and inform that process as well as we can for Scotland's interests.
Lewis McDonald.
Just as a brief supplementary to that, when you meet David Livingstone next week, will you ask him about UK government plans for preparing and publishing what options there might be in advance of the triggering of the Article 50?
Yeah, obviously, just as much as we think this government and should be as transparent as we can be, similarly, we'd expect the UK to keep people informed of where they are, and that's very important. And perhaps maybe in thinking about how we do this, obviously, the convener's relations with the Scotland Committee, etc., and Westminster will be important, I'm sure, as well, in making sure that there's a transparency to what they're doing.
Thank you.
Ash Denham.
Obviously, this issue, is going to have effects across other government portfolios, and sometimes quite severe effects across those. Clearly, the Scottish Government's taken steps to reassure, the business community about what might be happening in the future. And I know that you've got a business summit planned for next week to sort of engage with them. I'm just wondering what sort of feedback you've had, and maybe have they spoken to you about what their hopes might be for Scotland moving forward?
I think what's very striking is that, once people kind of have acknowledged and understood and coped with us with the result, is people move very quickly to, one, recognise the very strong leadership of our First Minister, acting very quickly and rapidly, but also very receptive and welcoming to the early approaches from the Scottish Government. And people are very open-minded and in terms of what they can try and do, and a willingness to put the Scottish interests first and foremost. I had a meeting with the British Hospitality Association yesterday on my tourism brief, and part of our discussion was the importance to the tourism industry of our European workers, the European Union workers, and the steps they've taken as employers, individual employers, in reassuring their own staff about their welcome and contribution. So across a range of portfolios, there's impacts to varying and different degrees. And I think what's very interesting is the response from Civic Scotland and also the third sector, the private sector, to recognising that we all have a job in hand to make sure that we're protecting our workforce and our business interests, but also we could try and think about solutions. So I think the capacity and willingness for people to help identify what can be done is absolutely there. It's our job to try and harness that and to bring bring it to bear to make sure we can influence the discussions going forward.
I have another supplementary from Richard Lockhead, and then Rose Greer.
Yeah, actually falls on well from Ash Denham's question there, because what I was wanting to just seek reassurance on was the fact that in determining the time of deciding the options for Scotland to stay in Europe, we have to also bear in mind that the negotiations themselves in the run-up to Brexit could take presumably many years, given the enormity of what has to be sorted out. In other words, there's potential to extend the two-year deadline, presumably under Article 50, once it's triggered. And if it turns out that once the can of worms is opened, this is going to last for years and years. Mm-hmm. Meanwhile, there's an impact on the Scottish economy, uncertainty for EU citizens,
and across a whole range of aspects of our society. So I take it that the government's taking that into account in terms of determining the timescale for deciding on the options for Scotland.
Absolutely, we've got to be conscious of the interests and needs and the different aspects of what it means for different sectors. I think some areas will want to move more quickly than others. For example, our universities have moved very, very quickly in some of their statements and some of the decisions they have to take, for example, with EU students coming in for the 2016 intake. And I want to put record my thanks and appreciation to all the higher education institutions for doing that, the ones that have done, and I think that's very, very important. So you'll see different people making different decisions at different points for their own sectoral interests, but certainly from the business perspective, people want to know that we are open for business, we want business, we've done very well in terms of our inward investment, we want that to continue, but we have to make sure that we're very realistic about what that is. So that's why we have to make sure that every single portfolio, and that's of the Scottish Government, is making sure that we can maximise our interests and protect Scotland's interests.
Ross Graham.
Thanks. Two relatively short questions, Cabinet Secretary. Glad to hear of the immediate engagement with other EU member states. Does the Scottish Government plan on direct engagements with each of the other 27 before what we assume might be the earliest activation of Article 50 in September? And second question on the Council of Experts. Was glad to hear there was an understanding of flexibility in its membership. Are there specific points in the process and specific individuals in mind for the development of its membership? I'm thinking specifically of our remaining MEPs. It was good to hear that David Martin's involved, but some of our other MEPs have, I think, quite substantial contributions to make there potentially.
And the first point in relation, what was the first question? Well, I'll answer the second question, and I'll remember the first question. In terms of the membership, and particularly in relation to our MEPs, our First Minister met with all the MEPs bar one yesterday. And I think I think you're right. We have got talented and talent and experience there in different areas. So certainly their role will be critical, and that's precisely why the First Minister made a point of making sure she could see them yesterday. So I can't relay, because obviously it's a short time since yesterday, as how that mechanism will be. But I understand you have Alan Smith and David Martin, who are probably some of the oldest. Not necessarily age-wise, but experience-wise. But clearly a former clerk to this committee has been elected, and a great deal of experience there as well. So I think we have to make sure that we're using all the talents. And the first question was in relation to who we're going to see and when. My experience is that it's better to secure the meetings and have the meetings and meet with people and then report from that. I think we're not necessarily telegraphing everything we can do, because for some countries they may not want that to be telegraphed. So that's part of the diplomacy of what we're doing. But even I know in the next few days I've already got meetings and appointments that were in train that will help this process as well. They were in train before the referendum, but they're more important now. So we regularly meet ministers and ambassadors from other countries, and that will continue. There'll be a different dimension to them now, but that's why the experience that this Parliament has built up, and the governments, our government and previous governments, in positive engagement with the European Union and its institutions will stand us, I think, in good stead going forward. And that is why I think the roles of our MEPs, Alan Smith and others, David Martin and his experience, and others, and ministers from different parties at different times, means that Scotland's voice can be heard. And that's the importance of being pro-European in our outlook and engaged. And that's the reputation this Parliament has, and the previous committee, the External Affairs Committee, has really helped in making sure that we can actually have that engagement when we need to do it. And Scotland's time is now, and the time for us to work together and to draw on that goodwill and translate it into something that is meaningful is now. And the seriousness of this, I'm sure, is not lost on anyone.
With that, thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. That ends this particular evidence session. Thank you, Cabinet Secretary and Mrs. Watt. We'll now have a short adjournment before our next panel of witnesses.